Hi, and welcome to my talk, Relating Requirements Implementation via Topics and via Topic Analysis. And the subtitle is, Do Topics Extracted from Requirements Make Sense to Managers and Developers? This was work done by me, Abram Hindle, along with Chris Bird, Thomas Zimmerman, and Nachi Nagapan at Microsoft Research. So this was done while I was visiting Microsoft Research. And they were nice enough to give me access to developers and managers, which made this possible. So, this is a topic, and it's used in things like LDA, and it comes out of text analysis. You throw in a bunch of documents, and it comes up with a topic, and it's a set of words. So, what is this topic about? The words are ordered by weight. So, what is the topic about? We've got code, improve, change, without functionality, behavior, readability, maintainability, structure, restructure, and or modify, reduce quality, process, complexity, software, refactoring, performance, source. So, if you had to summarize it in a couple of words, what would that be? Or a sentence? Did I hear refactoring? Well, that's probably a good description, but you could come up with other labels as well. How long did this take us? This took us, you know, at least a few seconds to read the topic, and then we had to determine it, what we'd call it, as well as discuss it. So this is what things like LDA produce. So if we're going to give them to developers and managers, we have to make sure it makes sense. So the reason we come across this is because we wanted to relate requirements to commits. Oftentimes implementation becomes out of sync with the actual requirements of the system, and at Microsoft we were given access to the requirements of a very large software system, so we wondered if we could produce links between these requirements documents and the commits. So one way to do it in sort of a loose fashion is to do it with topics. So we take requirements, we link them to topics, and then for every commit, using the commit log message, we infer the relationship between that commit and the topic. So we get a kind of traceability between the topics, the requirements documents, and the relevant commits as well. This would allow us to say things like, oh, these following commits were relevant to this, these requirements, which were related to this feature. Things like that. Also, we could name the topic, and then we could link the topics of requirements with the topics of commits. So the topics we're talking about are extracted from LDA. LDA is latent Dirichlet allocation. It's similar to LSI or principal component analysis. We use it to find independent word distributions within documents. Basically, these independent word distributions are kind of like statistical smells in the document where we can compose other documents, where we can compose the documents of these smells. So basically, given a set of documents, LDA will produce N topics, and it will produce a document topic matrix, which shows the relationship between documents and topics. The topics are not named or labeled, and the relationships between topics and future documents and other documents can be inferred. So a more concrete example would be, imagine the case where we have a newspaper, the New York Times, we could imagine, and inside there we have sections, and in these sections are articles. So if we had the problem where the section disappeared and we were left with the article, how would we determine what section each article was supposed to be in? Well, one way would be to manually read them. If there were enough articles, this would be very slow, we wouldn't want to do it. So maybe we could use something like LDA or LSI to do this for us. So LDA tries to cluster the documents. It reads the article and then tries to relate them to topics. So basically, to read the article, we have to parse article as a bag of words, basically word counts or word distributions. And then LDA tries hard to find independent word distributions relevant to the documents, and then it tries to relate these document word distributions to these independent word distributions. The idea is that you basically reduce the dimensionality by producing a smaller subset of word distributions, the number of topics, and the documents are related to these topics. But multiple documents can actually be related to the topics. So in here we have two news topics, sports and entertainment. And entertainment might be related to a baseball movie and an athlete and actor, but as well as award nominees. But award nominees might not be related to sports, but baseball movie would be related to both. So we can have multiple topics per document. The documents, basically, what we get out is a set of relationships of the topics to the documents, where it's almost like a dimensionality reduction, or almost like compression, or almost like a linear combination where we can rebuild the document from its topic association, but it's not quite the same. Furthermore, these topics are similar to magic. Their power is in their binding, and by that I mean that a topic that is not labeled, a topic that has not been bound to a name, doesn't have a lot of meaning, right? A topic that's unnamed needs to be interpreted. So here's two examples. So we got topic one and topic two. Play a game, inning, player, quarter, opponent, gambling, play, nightlife, comedy, movie, theater. On the slide it says sports and entertainment. Well, that makes it easy to interpret. If you didn't know it was sports and entertainment, you'd have to think about the topics and label them, much like the exercise at the start. Furthermore, LDA knows nothing about the English language and knows nothing about actual concepts, so it can't label them either. This kind of topic analysis is very popular in software engineering, used for a wide range of applications, from traceability to code metrics to discussion of s and source code summaries, querying. Some researchers have tried to validate the use of topics in software engineering. We had our topics aspects by Baldy et al., and also how does topic evolution relate to software evolution by Thomas et al. But when we made this study, no one had clearly attempted to validate topics with stakeholders such as managers and developers. So we wanted to see if these topics made sense. So our research goals were to determine if stakeholders can understand and label topics extracted from requirements. Furthermore, could they determine if the efforts relevant to a requirements topic match their perception of what occurred? So if I extract a requirements topic and I look at your commits and I produce a plot of your relevant commits to that topic, does that match your perception of what happened? So our methodology for topic mining was to get requirements, convert the requirements to word distributions by removing words and stemming, find a good number of topics, which we did manually by basically looking for topics which semantically make sense, which didn't have a lot of overlap, which didn't double duplicate themselves, things like that. So in the a good set of independent topics, and we found 20 was good for that. Then we ran LDA and we extracted the documents and the topics and the document topic matrix. And then once we had that, we then inferred the relationship to commit messages, and then we plotted this relationship over time in terms of relevance. The system that we applied this to was a Microsoft product with millions of users, millions of lines of code, 10 plus years of development, many, many authors and managers, over 500,000 changelog messages, 75 requirements documents from one module, over 150 pages of requirements documents, which averaged out to about 20 pages per document. So, what did we produce? Well, we produced this global relevance over time. So this plot's all normalized and I've got trends on it. But what it's really showing is 20 separate topics, and the trend towards those topics over time in the software. So we can see some topics are stable, we can see some topics have peaks, we can see the topic at the top here has a peak right there, and then it's pretty stable afterwards. Other topics, like this search and traces topic, goes down over time. There's like this inflection point where these two topics, use case features and testing metrics, go down, and then these two other features, the awareness based on Wi-Fi crowdsourcing, programming notifications, those increase. And we got things like volume, player, song, those increase. So there's this weird inflection point there. So we've got these different behaviors over time, and we can sort of get a overview, a kind of project dashboard of the kind of effort that's gone into them. And so what this is showing is really the relevance of commits. So that was by time. This one is a similar plot of the same topics, but by commit. So instead of normalizing the y-axis by time, it's now by commit. And so we see a little bit of a different behavior here. This peak here is actually this peak here. So you can see that about half the development occurred after this point. So it depends how you slice it, depends how you want to see it. We can also do things like look at the authors. We can look at author plots. We can see how they differ. So here's Wi-Fi code for one author and Wi-Fi code for another author. Looks somewhat similar. We can see that for roaming, setup, move, stuff, that there's two peaks there. Furthermore, we can see that there's a difference here. So there's an empty space here for networks, hotspots, and it's a bigger peak here. So these authors worked on this topic at different times. Whereas other topics, like these two topics here, they look like they correlate pretty well, as well as these ones. So we can see that certain authors work on certain things at different times. So you can compare authors, you can look at their effort and how their effort differed. You can also compare teams. Like for this team, one of the neat things is you can see that there's this big white space down here, right? So this team did not partake in development on the project during that time, whereas this team obviously did. As well as the teams differ, like this team has a lot more of this setup topic in the end than this team. Furthermore, the popularity of this blue topic increases, whereas for this team it doesn't. Both these teams have a lot of this topic and a lot of this one. So they have similar and different behavior, so you can compare groups of authors. So the neat thing about this is that by looking at slices of the commits, you can infer different things. So then we wanted to validate this. So we wanted to make sure it works with developers. So we tried 2-hour-long interviews with a developer and a manager. We then did an email survey, which had relatively poor response, and we did a face-to-face survey that was pretty well the same as the email survey. Except the difference is we promised it would take 10 minutes, and we showed up at their office and applied it. So when we interviewed the manager about these topic plots, it was very interesting. The manager could point to certain dips and peaks and describe them. In one case, he pointed to a long trough, a long dip, and he said that they shelved the feature at the time for that topic, and then later, when it came back up, they brought it back. So they decided not to work on a feature for a while, and then they worked on it again. The manager indicated that this provided a kind of useful project dashboard awareness that obviously was somewhat problematic to get. So the manager could label topics and point to behaviors, and was somewhat interested in it. When we showed these topics to developers, to a developer, the developer pushed back against it and didn't like the lack of clarity in the topics, labeled 2 of the 3 topics, and confirmed for 2 of the 3 topics that the perception, or he labeled 3 of the topics, but for 2 of the 3 topics, he confirmed that his perception of what he did related to that topic matched the plot. The other one he didn't think matched at all. Furthermore, he indicated that he was a lot more comfortable with the plots of his personal effort rather than the effort of others. So the global plot wasn't useful to him, whereas personal plot was. He also said he didn't think that this would be useful, and that maybe it'd be better for someone like a manager who might need it. So then we made a survey, and we sent it via email, and we sent it via, and we administered in person. This survey required you to read a topic, like this topic 6, name the topic, and tell us if the topic was relevant. Furthermore, it showed you a plot of the effort you had, and you personally marked, you verified to see if this plot matched your perception of the effort that went into the topic or the features of your effort. And we also asked if they recognize any of the spikes. And in many cases, they could recognize spikes. In a lot of cases, it was things like releases or new features or other events. There was a lot of release correlation. So in terms of the topics, we had cases where there was agreement in what the topic was about. So we had this topic, data use file request. And then we thought this was use case features. We didn't know what the GAT is. We thought this was a junk topic. And the respondents all said the word setup. Each one mentioned that it was set up for a device or an application. So they had agreement there. There's topics where there wasn't agreement. So we had this one, test device scenario, pass team automation. And we said this was relevant to testing and power. The first respondent said it wasn't coherent. The second respondent said it was connectivity. Third one said it wasn't coherent. And the fourth one said it was related to networking and generic words. So two of the respondents agreed. Two of the other respondents disagreed. So there's general disagreement in some of the topics. So when we summarize whether or not people's perception of those topic plots matched their perception of the effort, we found that about 46% agreed overall. And then if you ignore not applicable and neutral, so topics that work, 63% agreed. But 46% said, 46% agreed that the topic plots matched their perception. One interesting observation was, and it was based on the agreement as well, our study, we used non-experts to label the topics first, so we labeled the topics, and only 50% of the labels that we applied agreed with the stakeholder labels. So our recommendations on the use of topics in software engineering was that labels matter. Topics can take, you know, 2 to 3 minutes to label. An hour of labeling topics is probably too long of time. Many of the topics are confusing, and the developers really didn't like that. They also didn't like junk topics that didn't have any good words in them to latch onto, so there's irrelevant topics. Furthermore, it felt like topic labelers, people who label topics, if they labeled something they're familiar with, we got better quality labels. Furthermore, we recommend, therefore, that one use domain experts. The future work would be to rely on some of the hints by the developers to provide querying and editing of topics so you could slice and dice the topics, maybe produce new ones and infer relationships, as well as dump bad topics. Furthermore, we'd love it if we could do more people and more projects, because this was only one large project with a couple of people. In terms of actionable results, well, it's interesting. Topic plots are perceptually accurate according to stakeholders much of the time. This kind of stuff could be integrated into dashboard products like Visual Studio Project Dashboard. One could better track effort related to specs, maybe through this method. And furthermore, traceability could be aided if we had more commit metadata about maybe the context in which the commit occurred. In conclusion, we felt that stakeholders can understand and label topics, and we found that topics sometimes, about 43 to 63% of the time, depict the effort associated with a topic. Therefore, we were getting some traceability information between requirements and implementation, even though it was a little loose. Can non-experts label topics? Yes, but the performance wasn't great. It was about 50%, so one should be careful. We didn't think that the raw topics were really appropriate for stakeholders. They don't really like dealing with them. So if one's going to present topic results to stakeholders, the topic results should probably include a label in order to aid understandability. Were these results statistically significant? No, but the value of this study is we applied it to real programmers, and it showed that these topic assumptions about the utility of these topics, at least in terms of usability by programmers and managers, might not be accurate. We should be pretty careful about when we are applying, when we actually get real people involved, because some of this stuff, you know, doesn't work as well as we hope. But at the same time, some of it does work, so that's pretty interesting. So we showed that some does work as well. So, you know, caveats and all. All right, thanks.